In his home atop the highest point in Danville, Kentucky, Stephen Powell lives in a world of glass. It's a realm of light to which this glass artist adds his own kaleidoscope of colors.
If I had my choice, I would like to live inside one of my vessels, maybe, and, you know, be able to look out and see all the colors.
When he and his wife, Shelley, designed the house, their guiding themes were color and light.
Those five rondelles, the windows, you know, were particularly there because the sun travels through in the morning. And it's really great to wake up as the sun's coming right across those windows.
At the Powell House, even hand washing is an experience awash with color. From the sink-a-delic experience in the bathrooms to the glass pillars on the porches, Stephen has turned his home and his life into a work of art.
Now I feel that is the function of art, is to enhance life.
There used to be even more glass, but since he and Shelley first built the place, there have been a couple of changes. Their names are Zachary and Oliver.
They're small glass bashers at this point, so we have to be real careful.
Their parents have put all the glass up high. Even so, it often catches the eyes of 2-year-old Zach when he's not busy.
He can actually walk around the house, and he, of course, goes, "Daddy made this, Daddy made that."
Tonight, Zach's daddy is making colored glass beads called Marini, which he'll use to decorate a circular window called a rondelle. To make the Marini, he first has to raise some cane. Stephen and his assistants start by picking up rods of colored glass. Stephen is firing up 2 rods of translucent orange in the 2300-degree fury of the glory hole.
I'm really drawn to the fire and process. I'm a self-confessed pyromaniac.
2 wooden paddles help Stephen combine the 2 rods.
What we're trying to prevent is gaps between the glass, which would be air bubbles.
Stephen twists the molten tornado of glass into shape. He adds a coating of clear glass to separate the orange from the next shade. Then a dollop of red is plopped on top.
Essentially, you have an orange glass on the interior, a coating of clear, a coating of red ruby.
Stephen squashes the new color onto the old. Then he heats the pair and rolls the ruby around the orange. When the overlay is complete, Stephen is ready to stretch hot glass until it forms a long, skinny rod known as cane. This taffy pull requires intense teamwork because the heat is rarely even throughout the pull.
Still holding thickness?
Stephen pulls for 40 feet or until he reaches the end of his rope.
When I'm against the wall, you need to back up.
The steaming cane will be ready for chopping in a few days. Then they cut it into hundreds of tiny Marini beads. Guided by 20 years' experience, Stephen mixes and matches Marinis into multiple patterns.
And I think we all have some sort of emotive reaction to color, whether we're aware of it or not.
Stephen Powell's Marini beads will make another journey into the inferno before the color within explodes into life. As Stephen Powell walks through his home in Danville, Kentucky, he moves among his own messengers of light.
It's something that's difficult to put into words, but they're just pieces that I have an emotional reaction to, just like I do another person.
The Marini beads he's made wink at him from voluminous vessels.
And the vessels are like a canvas for the colors that I do.
Tonight, Stephen's canvas will be a circular window called a rondelle. He'll make the rondelle using the same Marini beads he uses in his vases. He starts with a few gathers of clear glass, which he rocks and rolls into a symmetrical mass. While Stephen cools down the glass, D.H. McNabb heats up the Marini beads, preparing them for the big pickup. The next move can only be made once.
If we don't do a good job of picking those up, where the seam meets up relatively even, or sometimes we just miss Marinis, and that's the first critical point.
Hey, let's get those Marinis. Okay, let's get those yellow ones next.
And the race is on. If they move fast enough, they can replace some of the missing Marinis.
You can get those yellow ones in there. I think we got them all on. One might be slightly sideways, but you know they're handmade.
Stephen melts the beads into the hot glass. He cuts the clear glass off the end, pulling the Marinis to the center. Then, Chris Bohack and Stephen get ready to blow up the glass ball. The merry-go-round of color goes for another ride in the glory hole as they prepare to break it.
Pretty critical step here. If it doesn't break off right, it's too cool, it could crack.
Paul Hugis attaches a rod, or pontil, to the other end of the glass ball, and Stephen cuts the blowpipe free.
I'm ready any time. Ready?
And so now we're holding the piece from the bottom instead of the top.
Now it has a mouth, which Stephen opens wide for the final spin out.
All right, that's good. Let's go for it here.
If we don't heat it correctly, we end up with a bowl, or it touches back and doesn't open. So, you know, that spin out is really critical.
Don't lean back, Paul. Whatever you do, keep turning. A little more speed.
When the rondelle is stable, they break it free, and Chris puts it in the annealing oven to finish cooling. 2 days later, assistant Laura Ward helps Stephen install the new rondelle, adding even more cheerful hues to his brightly lit bathroom.
I guess it's safe to say that I think that I'm hoping to make something that's beautiful.
Even as night falls over the Powell household, a mysterious luminescence radiates into the dark. Stephen Powell has pushed back the curtain of black with a galaxy of colors.